Hey guys, today we're going to be doing a motor swap, adding more traction and more power to this vehicle. So what we have in the shop today is what you typically see for these little electric vehicles. Usually you know them as Power Wheels, and there's a bunch of off-brands. This is an off-brand version of it, but typically these are all 6 volt, so which is great when the kids are young because they know how to manage, it's easier for them to manage. Now that he's a little bit older, we're going to give him a little bit more power, and the main thing is we want to give him a lot more traction. So what's interesting about these, you can see that here's the motor for the drive wheel. But you can see on the other side, there's a provision for it. And when we look underneath, the wheel on the other side is cogged as well. So some of these models are already two-wheel drive. We can also see here the battery that that's provided. There's a lot of space, so we can put in something bigger in here. So we can see inside, we have our controller, and we have one motor for our drive wheel. But you can see this chassis is designed to take a secondary one. And when we look underneath, the other side of the wheel is cogged as well. Over here where the battery is, you see we have lots of room, so we can put in something bigger in here. So there must be other models out there that have more drive wheels and also have bigger capacity batteries. So we're gonna show you guys, just like a real vehicle, what the limitations are when you're just running, when you have less power and also less drive wheels going. So here it is in one wheel drive. So he's gonna drive forward. So you see, once he breaks traction, he obviously, with only one drive wheel, he has issues going. You got a lot of traction issues with just the one wheel only spinning. Go up. Go forward. Whenever dealing with more power, heat is going to be a byproduct. So we have to up the capacity of everything, and that's mainly the wiring. So we're going to put thicker wires on here, and you can see over here on our upgraded battery, we have a fuse and we also have a 2-pin trailer connector. That way I can wire this the same way as the old connector, but I'm using my connectors instead. So I've identified positive and negative, pretty simple, it's labeled for us, and I'm going to use a soldering iron with variable heat. Usually I have it up almost 75% for most wiring jobs, especially if I have to pull it out because it has to cool down a bit as you're walking away. But on situations like this with circuit boards, I turn it right down. Sometimes using soldering wick will help you, but we're gonna heat it up now, try to pull this out. There's no sense in trying to connect to these wires because they're already thin. So you got to pull them out if you want to have proper capacity, a proper increase in capacity. Okay, let's go ahead and solder this. In the circuit board, you got to be quick. You can't expose it to too much heat. Now you guys can see, looking underneath, it's pretty simple. You have an axle, and then you just they provide you with a zap strap basically to hold the drive motor on. But you see on the other side, it's just begging to be powered up. So now we have to take off the hub caps to get the wheel off. Use a pry tool like this, or a flathead screwdriver if you don't have one. And that'll expose this pin over here so we can remove it.
Yep, Dad.
Okay, buddy, let's take the wheel off. Two hands, pull it off. There you go. With that zap strap removed, might have a washer right here. And then the motor will just come right out. Make sure you unplug everything. And our new motor will just slip right off. Our new motor has provisions over here, so we're probably gonna screw it in and still add a zap strap to make it more secure to the chassis. Here's a tip for zap straps or zip ties. If you have If you buy good quality ones, you can take your pliers and just twist it a bit and get a couple more clicks out of it. This makes sure it's really tight. And whenever dealing with zip ties, we always want to make sure we cut off the ends flush. Okay, do all the other ones. So he's making sure that he's getting the flush side, because they are flush cuts, all the way to the end. And then he gets a nice clean cut. Okay, last one over here.
Why nice clean cut?
Because we care.
This one is going to be a tricky one.
Okay.
There's mess over on my side. There you go.
Now, I didn't like the original design because it had a lot of play. If we look over here on the drive system, if it comes out too much, we don't have as much of the wheel into the cog. So what we did is we just added a couple more washers, and then to help free it up, to make sure there's no friction, I'm using fluid film. And the reason why I'm cool with this is there's tons of plastic parts here. It's safe to use this on plastics as well. So when you guys are wiring up the motors, you will try to wire them technically out of phase because they're facing opposite directions, but test it. So even though I thought I did, I guess just, it depends, I guess, how they have it rotated when they do final assembly. So what I had to do was I had to flip them again at the controller, because what was happening was one was going forward, the other was going in reverse. We don't want that. So you just flip one of the wires or make them opposite. That way they go the same direction. The other thing I did was, what I didn't like was, I understand why they did it. The original wiring is, if they went up like this, it would be forward and then pull it back for backwards. I understand the orientation, but because this is replicating an actual vehicle, I decided if on an actual vehicle, if you're in neutral, going down into drive on a column shifter would be down, neutral, and then going up would be reversed. So I wanted him to recognize that. So, because like, if you drive this for years, then you go get into a, when you have your license, you go into another vehicle, it'll feel really foreign. So I figured let's start training him properly now. Our newer 12 volt battery is a little bit taller, so to make the battery holder fit, we have to cut it a little bit. So as you guys can see, I kept the factory connector in here because I wanted it to be different than our plug-in connector. Just in case someone's trying to charge it and they accidentally plug it in, I don't want the motors to activate, so this way it makes it dummy-proof. Right now we're going to do an unloaded test. So we originally put it in here because I've been seeing everyone's putting in 30 amp fuses with the two motors, or when they're stepping up to a 12 volt, but a lot of people are just putting in a 12 volt battery and not upping the motors to proper 12 volt ones. So what we're going to do here is we're just going to see what it does when it initially starts, see the spike, and see what is nominal. Okay, Riker, hit it. Keep going. Hold it, hold it, hold it. So we see it will spike between 13 to 14 amps on initial start, and then when it's nominally running, it goes down to about 3. So the only reason we're putting in a bigger fuse is because we're trying to handle that spike, because it's like instant torque on. Also keep in mind, I have this thing off the ground, so we can try it again with some weight on it. I'm gonna put the weight down it. I'm just gonna hold it back. Let's see what it spikes up to. Okay, hit it. Yeah, so we saw it climbed with resistance, spinning the wheels, it climbed to 28 amps. So it's gonna be pushing hard. This might, we have to monitor the wiring. I believe the wiring is more than able to handle 30 amps, but then we have to see if that fuse is gonna be happy. So we have our battery holder in now, and we have our JDM spacer. This way, I didn't want this to come down and start crushing the case of the battery. So this way, with it notched up in here, it's tight, but you're not putting a lot of pressure on the battery itself. If you decide to secure the motors with screws, keep in mind that they're going to protrude. You could do a nut and bolt if you wanted to. You might have to cut this off, or you can use some sort of strip caulk and then cover it. That way you remove this. You can also grind off the point as well. Go, hold it. Go through the grass. Let's see what it does.
That's just like a race car.
Yeah, let's go. Hold it. You see, it handles grass way easier now. More traction, way more power. got a lot of traction issues with just the one wheel only spinning. Okay. So remember, these are the stock tires. We're gonna see how it goes on the rocks. Okay, let's go. So watching it on grass is impressive because he just accelerates so quick and picks up a lot of speed afterwards. So keep in mind, you have to watch out for this. You want to be able to catch up, so you will have to run to catch up to him. So keep in mind, because it is now two-wheel drive and the wheels are now spinning at the exact same speed, like a true GM, it has a horrible turning radius. So that's something else you have to keep in mind, is like they're not going to be as maneuverable, not a big deal at this low of a speed, but it is something to consider. Now also keep in mind that today we're using a battery that you typically would find in a fire suppression system or security system. It's a traditional lead acid battery. It's just 12 volts and it's the biggest one that's designed to fit in here. In later videos, we are going to switch this out for a lithium ion version, and then we're probably going to add a secondary one running in parallel to give us more capacity. So this is the charger that I'm using now with the 2-pin, and I kind of wired everything based on this because we'd use this on trickle charging vehicles, motorcycles, whatever. So what I like about this is it's a maintainer. You can set it and forget it. It's safe. It's not going to kill the battery. If anything, it's going to prolong the life of that battery.
The motor won't work if you put the buttons on. Go slow, go
speed. Is that driver feedback?
Yeah.
Okay, so the one thing we noticed is the runtime compared to the 6 volts, because we have two motors now, is less than half. So I think what we're going to have to do is we're going to have to get another battery or two and have them on hand if he wants to play on this thing a little bit longer. Or we can do maybe something over here where I can run the plug out to here if I want to have a really big capacity. I like the idea of it in here and getting rest periods, one for him so he can get a drink, eat some food. Also to keep the motors cool, because if it's just running non-stop, it's really hard on the motor. So at least if you do some pit stop breaks, we let it cool down. So I cannot stress this enough, guys, this is a lot more power and it's going to be a lot faster. So be prepared to be running to keep up with this thing. Make sure you're in a safe area, because the rate of travel on these things is so much faster. The operator might not be ready to make reactions. I would not drive this thing anywhere near traffic. Be as safe as possible. Well guys, there you have it. That's how you can convert your power wheels or your little electric car over from 6 volt to 12 volt. It's not the hardest thing. The main thing you want to make sure is you use thick wiring on this, because you're going to throw more power at it, and try to test it if you can. So what in the future videos we're going to do is we're going to modify the tires. We're going to take some mountain bike tires to give it even more traction. That way these plastic guys don't get so beaten up and it actually gives it an actual tread. And we might do some provisions and add additional power supply so we can get more reserve capacity out of this thing.